Welcome to the Daily Glasgow Cappuccino. Start each day of COP26 by drinking in a few minutes of warm, stimulating conversation about climate resilience. I'm your host, Peter Willis from The Resilience Shift. Shall we begin? My guest on this morning's Cappuccino is Professor Johan Rockström. Johan has been the joint director of the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research in Germany since 2018. Prior to that, he founded and directed the Stockholm Resilience Centre at Stockholm University and was director of the Stockholm Environment Centre. He is particularly well known for having developed the Planetary Boundaries Framework for scientifically establishing the safe operating space for humanity. Johan is a highly effective and well-known speaker on the climate emergency. So thank you and welcome, Johan, to today's Cappuccino. Very glad to have you with us. I and the Resilience Shift work with a lot of leaders who are grappling with the challenge of climate change from a leadership perspective. What is it that you most want to land in the minds of leaders right now, at this moment in time, around the idea of resilience?
I think there are two dimensions that I think we urgently need to have a much, much deeper insight around. I mean, the number one is, of course, that there is no safe landing at 1.5 degrees Celsius, meaning delivering on the Paris Climate Agreement, only by engineering-wise phasing out fossil fuels, which is our prime focus in all the climate negotiations. It is equally important. In fact, it is a prerequisite to have any chance of success that we sustain and safeguard the resilience in the Earth system, which means all the carbon sinks and all the carbon flows and the functioning of the living biosphere. We know, for example, in our latest analysis that if it hadn't been for the resilience in the Earth system, even just on terrestrial ecosystems on land, meaning soils and wetlands and rainforests and temperate forests, we would have passed through 1.5 degrees Celsius already today. So we have resilience in the Earth system to thank for the stability up till today. But we also know that all the climate models in the IPCC that gives us a remaining global carbon budget of roughly 400 or 500 billion tons of carbon dioxide, which enables us to have a potentially a soft landing of phasing out fossil fuels by net zero world economy by 2050, all of that relies entirely on the assumption that the resilience in the planet will continue. There is no silver bullet to solve the climate crisis. There's no linear solution. We need diversity, redundancy, which are elements of resilience. We talk often of, for example, just electrifying the whole world economy as being this leap from oil to electricity. Well, of course, that may be the ultimate outcome in one generation, two generations, but the pathway to get there will require resilience thinking, meaning investing in multiple options, complex interactions, failures and success, learning by doing, you know, all these factors that we include when we define resilience as the ability to live and develop with change, to be adaptive and flexible.
I find that fascinating, the way you describe particularly that first point about the resilience in the global ecosystem providing us the basis on which to do this transition into a zero carbon economy. And it strikes me how much the resilience debate and discourse is carried on in a sort of urban-centric, business-centric way, and I don't hear much in that discourse about the Earth systems that you're describing there. For a lot of businesses and corporations, and maybe even governments, the idea of resilience is around making your organization or your city resilient to climate shocks, and you're addressing it from a level underneath that.
One of the dire mistakes we're making, where we are kind of interpreting resilience as only being our ability to cope with shocks, meaning basically build walls against extreme events, droughts, floods, heat waves, fires, all forms of extremes originating from environmental change. So we have this paradox that we humans are the drivers, we are powering up the Earth system to hit back with very hard extreme events. And we're powering up with more energy through global warming. It's not only about reducing the pressure on the Earth system, it's also recognizing that there's something in between. There's this buffering capacity, nature's ability to be our best friends in helping us to navigate this pressure. So it's not only that we need to reduce the stress levels, we also need to be stewards, we need to manage and govern the capacity of all the living components in the Earth system to continue helping us in dampening and reducing the impact of the extremes that we are ourselves causing. For example, at the Glasgow climate negotiations, to see this as the first nature COP, the moment when we factor in and build into our policy discussions, not only decarbonizing the global energy systems, but also keeping the resilience in our living biosphere intact. And that this is my biggest worry, actually, that we are not only moving in the wrong direction on fossil fuel emissions, not having bent the global curve yet, but we're also losing resilience in the living biosphere. I mean, just look at what's happening with the Amazon rainforest, look at the tropical coral reef systems, look at overfishing in the oceans, which leads to a degradation of the whole food web. Just look at what's happening on our cryosphere systems. All of the, you know, living biosphere systems that help us as long as they are resilient, but can self-amplify global warming if they cross thresholds and lose resilience. So it's not kind of a linear journey upwards or downwards. It can be non-linear when systems flip over from one state to another. So there's more into it than just a tool for dampening. It's also the risk of self-amplifying if we cross tipping points. So we are today driving the negative trajectories by burning fossil fuels, but we cannot exclude that the planet takes over and becomes itself the self-emitter of greenhouse gases. And that moment, we lose control. And that would be the moment when we shift from a resilient Earth system to a non-resilient Earth system.
Yes, you're making me realize that this is an extremely uncommon, I would say probably a unique thinking challenge for Homo sapiens. We don't have any genetic coding for thinking about what you've just described there. But I just want to end, if I may, by coming to this word we, which you've used a lot. It's very easy these days to refer to humanity and to we as though we are capable of acting as a single organism. How are we doing in your perspective?
Well, we're not doing very well, unfortunately. I mean, that should be recognized at the outset that we established the United Nations as we, you know, rebuilt after the Second World War, and recognizing the need for universal, fundamental human rights, clear codes of conduct between all nations in the world. And now, 70 years later, when we need trust and universal principles for collaboration across all human beings on Earth, we are unfortunately at an all-time low in our ability to do so. When the United Nations Environment Program was born in 1972 after the Stockholm Conference, and today, We have a Paris Agreement that is legally binding at the upper floor, but is all voluntary when it comes to what nations are supposed to do. So basically, we've gone one step backwards from the Kyoto Protocol, even from 1997. Now, is there any light in the tunnel in that, let's call it, quite messy world that we live in today? And I would argue that the answer is yes. COVID-19 and the pandemic proved that we are able to rise as one community across all nations in the world in the face of an immediate crisis. Understanding of interconnectedness, I think, is actually in an all-time high in a situation where our governance capacity is weak. And that is positive in the sense that it shows that there is kind of a direction of travel of trying to find more common universal ground. You know, all these things are starting to sink in, and people don't talk of it as resilience perhaps, but it is actually articulations of concern over the resilience of the planet. And I do foresee that this hopefully is a moment of, an honest discussion of our failures so far and the need to really strengthen global governance and to hand over some power to more democratic, but also global governance institutions. And I think the only way for us to have any chance of keeping thriving biomes on planet Earth is that we plug them into a global commons governance regime for resilience, which would allow new mechanisms for financial compensation for those nations that are stewards of these critical biomes for the resilience that would benefit all of us. And that we don't have that mechanism today, but I think we need to develop it very rapidly.
On that inspiring note, Johan, I want to thank you most warmly, and I want to thank you for everything you're doing in the world. All power to your elbow, you and your colleagues.
Thanks for this very rich conversation. Thanks.